Kitco News special coverage of the Future Blockchain Summit is brought to you by Cook Finance, a revolution in DeFi asset management.
Our next guest is Ian Khan. Ian, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, David.
Thanks for being here. Ian is a technological futurist. He's a filmmaker as well. You've got a few credited titles under your name, including The Blockchain City, GX Now, and your latest documentary, which we'll be discussing today, is The Bitcoin Dilemma. And I want to ask you what the dilemma is, of course. But first, I have an interesting proposition for you. I'm going to name a few sci-fi movies or titles, franchises, each of them covering a different theme of the future. And I want to talk about how likely it is that some of these themes will become reality over the next, I want to say within our lifetimes. And I want to talk about the impact to society, okay? So the first one is my personal favorite movie, The Matrix series. The idea that we're all living in some sort of virtual reality or simulation, and we're all hooked up to, not necessarily like a battery, but we're all sort of living and interacting with people through virtual reality, otherwise known as a metaverse.
Yeah. So the metaverse is here. I mean, unless we're already living in the Matrix and we don't know about it, let's go beyond that. But the evolution of the metaverse has started. There's a huge investments coming from really big tech on the metaverse, including Facebook and other companies. Things are being traded now on the metaverse. So, you know, digital art is being traded, and there's many, many interesting things happening on the metaverse. It is happening, and this is the time to get involved.
Okay. We were talking about AI offline. So iRobot, Will Smith's movie, the idea that in the future we'll have robots in the form of a human sort of perform our tasks for us, potentially think for themselves and possibly be dangerous to society.
I think we're still about a couple of decades away from having robots that are intelligent, that have some kind of artificial general intelligence built into them, and they're actually able to do things in a more humanistic way. But no, we're still getting there.
What's keeping us away? Is it the hardware or the software?
I think it's just the convergence of the hardware and the software. Okay. Separately, they work okay, but it still needs intelligence built into it. Okay. But things are moving in that direction.
I don't know if you remember this movie from the 90s, The Fifth Element, yes. Bruce Willis, flying cars. When can we see flying cars?
I think it's more like a regulatory issue in flying cars and a little bit of technology as well. We're not there yet where we can have super condensed jet propulsion engines. So that technologically, that aspect hasn't been mastered yet. I would say another 25 to 30 years.
But we do have actually flying taxis coming soon. I mean, the UK just built its first hub from Hyundai. It's called, it's literally an airport. It's called, they're going to be building a few of those around the world. So it basically looks like a big drone that people can be in. So I think
absolutely. And in Dubai as well, they had this launch 5 years ago with Volocopter, and they said they'll have flying taxis here. I think we're still away from it. It's still a hype. Maybe at least 10, 15 years ago.
Is it the 10, 15 years or so? Is it the technology that we're not fully seeing, or is it the regulatory side that you mentioned?
I think it's the regulations as well as the commercial viability of it, right. Rather, you know, actual people using it on an everyday basis.
Would you use a flying car?
I would, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, if it saves me time, energy, cost, then why not a self-driving flying car as well?
Right, exactly, yeah. Well, let's talk about self-driving cars. I mean, there's a lot of movie examples that use those. Tom Cruise's movie about, I can't remember the name, but he was a cop that could foresee the future. But there were you know, autonomous cars in that movie as well. So
Minority Report.
That's it. Minority Report. Yeah. So that's happening already. The technology is developing. There's a lot of startups working on that. Big companies are working on that as well already. But we're not seeing that massively adopted yet.
So self-driving car technology has multiple levels to it. Say level 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. We are at level number 1.5. Level number 2 right now. For autonomous cars to be all intelligent and do what they need to do, they need to be at level 5, and we're not there yet. In the labs, who knows who's got the level 5 car? They might, but I don't think we're there yet.
Would you say that's a disruptive technology? I mean, is it going to completely revolutionize automobile consumption? What's going to happen to the taxi industry, for example, if you can just hail an Uber that's self-driving?
I think over the long term, or the next 20 years, yes, the auto industry will be very different. Transportation will be different. Yeah. But here we need to keep in mind It's also regulations. It's also the roads that need to be prepared and equipped for the technology. Right now, you can't have those autonomous cars on the roads everywhere because we have people driving as well. Yeah. And unless we don't have people off the roads, because insurance gets involved, right? Sure. There's many other players in the equation. So I think another 15 to 20 years, maybe we have a society where we've got all autonomous cars.
Yeah. Just on a note on cars, I think electric vehicles are developing simultaneously with the advancement of autonomous vehicles. In fact, they're moving in tandem. There are many jurisdictions around the world, including the state of New York, state of California, the UK, for example, recently banned the sale of petrol vehicles after a certain year. I think in the UK it's 2030, in New York it's 2035. So they're really not letting it's not just a matter of government subsidies or encouragement, they're banning the sale of petrol cars. So that's shifting very fast in some places. What's that gonna do for our infrastructure, our grid, and of course the automobile industry?
I think 2030, if it is 2030, is too early to ban conventional fuel-based, fossil fuel-based automobiles and cars and transportation.
I don't think they're banning them on the road, they're banning the sale, so.
Yeah. Still, I think it's early. Because number one, the energy industry, it doesn't like it. The oil companies will not like it. And second, that means all the automobile manufacturers have to essentially stop selling those cars. And it's two big dinosaurs that you need to fight with in order to get forward. I do expect that deadline to move forward, maybe 2045, something around that time. But purely because there's a huge movement of things that needs to take place. But I do believe that battery-powered cars are the way of the future. They're rapidly increasing. They're great for the environment. They're great for the consumer. And I do hope and believe they will be, growing in numbers as we go forward.
The argument that EVs are better for the environment, I'll just leave it at that. Is that a statement you agree with or disagree with?
I partially agree with it. Yes, on the emission side, Absolutely. On the emission side, it's good. But when we look at the responsible disposal of the batteries that are in there, we've got to be really careful about what's happening to those batteries, what's happening to recycling them, because they contain a lot of lead, other chemicals, polonium and so on, that need to be disposed of in the right way.
This next one's not a movie per se, it's a video game that came out recently, Cyberpunk 2077. So the idea that a chip can be inserted into your brain and you can download and upload information at will. Neuralink, which is a company that Elon Musk is involved with right now, is working on exactly that. So how likely is that to be part of our everyday consumption?
I don't think it'll happen for at least the next decade and a half. It's just way too intrusive on the human body. It's not going to happen realistically, but I love the idea. And yes, Neuralink is one of the companies that's working on it. There's other companies that are developing similar things. They've got great products. One of my upcoming documentaries is called AI, The Next Frontier.
Right.
And I'm interviewing somebody who's researching brain implants and they've been working on it. So that's something interesting.
Finally, let's talk about the next frontier for mankind, which is space. Space exploration is hot right now. You've got Jeff Bezos, you've got Virgin Galactic. So Star Trek, another one of my personal favorites in franchises. When's that gonna happen?
I don't think Star Trek literally will happen for another 30 years. It's not possible.
30. I mean, no. It's literally based hundreds of years from now. So the fact that you said 30 is pretty encouraging.
To some extent, not the full extent, right? But I do feel, based on what we've seen in the last 10, 20 years, the next 30 could be really promising when you've got some kind of commercial space travel happen. I don't know if we'll transport ourselves at quantum speeds and we'll have wormholes. I don't know about that.
Yeah.
But definitely the technology will be up ahead.
Well, do you think space travel will be commercially viable for the average man? Will it be affordable? Can we go from London to New York via space travel at an affordable rate like a plane right now?
The question is, would that be of any benefit or not? And that's the bottom line. If there's a benefit to it in terms of, hey, you can do that in 1 hour now, then somebody will find a way to commercialize it and sell it. And there will be people who will buy it,
right?
And that's literally it. Technologies, there's many incredible technologies, but they need to be commercialized in order to be viable. So we'll see. I don't know.
Well, look, the airline travel was off limits for most people when it came out. I mean, now we're in Dubai. I mean, I'm not based in Dubai, so obviously it's accessible now. Do you think airline travel could become even more accessible in the future? Could it be even as cheap as a bus, let's say? If everybody had a flying car, that, well, it wouldn't go transatlantic, but you know what I mean, right? Could airline travel be as affordable as public transportation today? Do you see that happening?
To answer that, the cost of living is increasing, right? You get a bread for 10 times what you used to get it, you know, 50 years ago. I think in the future, it might be a little bit more affordable, but I'm not saying it'll be as cheap as a bus ticket.
Yeah.
But, you know, salaries will increase, people will make more money. So yeah, it might be something that there will be more off, people will travel more. Yes, for sure.
Let's bring it back to blockchain now. We are at a blockchain conference. Let's talk about your documentary. It premiered at the conference just this week on Monday. Congratulations.
Thank you.
What's the dilemma with blockchain?
So the film is the Bitcoin dilemma, and the dilemma behind Bitcoin and every cryptocurrency is, what is it?
Well, first of all, are you differentiating Bitcoin from the rest of blockchain? Is it just focused on Bitcoin?
No, the film is about Bitcoin and the cryptocurrency industry, with Bitcoin being the primary face of crypto today, because it was the first cryptocurrency to come out. It's the golden child of crypto, as you can, if we can say that. But the dilemma is really, what exactly is crypto? How does it change my life? What should I do with it? These are the questions in everybody's minds. Every common person out there in the world has these questions, right? You have a set of people who are traders, who are trading crypto, who are pumping crypto. You've got influential people pumping cryptocurrencies and saying, hey, this is the greatest thing ever. We're going to accept crypto for our payments, for our whatever you want to buy from us.
Yeah.
That's great. So the common person starts thinking, is this something that I need to do and put my 401k into, put my investments into? And that's the dilemma. The dilemma is, it's an industry that's not regulated.
Yeah.
It doesn't have global regulations. So what do? Put our money into it or not? Invest or not? Take it seriously or not? And that's what the film is all about, is answering the questions about what exactly is going on, what's the future of crypto, how has money changed over the last, you know, thousands of years, and what is it now, and how is it moving forward?
Yeah.
And so all those questions are being answered by experts in their own domain in the documentary, and people like the ex-chief economist of the SEC, Chester Spatt, he's in there talking about money. Mark Yusko, investor, trader, hedge fund manager, and you've got incredible people from the Bitcoin Foundation. I also have Limon Baird, who's a cryptocurrency inventor and creator, and all of these people are talking about what is the future and where are things going. So that's what the film is all about.
Absolutely. Okay, where can we watch this film before we move on?
So the film is on YouTube. First of all, you can watch it on YouTube. Just type the Bitcoin Dilemma movie. You'll find it. Type my name, you'll find it. And it'll also be on some video on demand platforms as we go through, the next few months.
We'll put the link to the video in the video description.
And it's freely available. So yeah.
Thank you for that. Okay, I want to talk about Bitcoin as both a currency and an asset class. Let's make that distinction. So on the asset class front, do you think Bitcoin can become or will become a mainstream asset class being adopted by all institutional funds and retail investors alike, like stocks, for example? Stocks are an asset class. Institutional investors have adopted stocks. Do you think Bitcoin can fit that category in the future?
I think to some extent it might. I mean, I think two things are going for Bitcoin generally. Number one, it's the poster child for cryptocurrencies because it was the first one. So that's great. It's a good brand image to have. Bitcoin is, however, not the most efficient cryptocurrency. It has a fairly good sized carbon footprint, but the efficiency has definitely come into play over the years. It does not consume as much electricity as it does in the past. So all the bad things associated with Bitcoin are not necessarily true today. Things have changed in the last decade and a half. So that's one side of it. Another side of it is that Bitcoin has the limited supply. So any trader who's trading in anything, whether it's stocks, bonds, it's commodities, they know the supply and demand rule. Anything that's less in supply, more demand, right? Bitcoin has a limited supply. It'll always be 21 million coins, out of which I think 85% of them are already mined. and you've left with the rest of, you know, 10, 15% of Bitcoin. So I think it'll always have value. It'll always increase in value. And we're seeing that from NFTs right now. They're being sold for astronomical prices, 60 million, millions of dollars, and it'll keep on increasing, right? So don't be surprised if the next big NFT is 100 million or $200 million. And so for those two reasons, Bitcoin will always be sought after. And it's got nothing to do with the fluctuations. That's a different thing. Is it a long-term stable asset class, currency to invest in? I don't know about that. Probably an investor can,
asset manager can talk. Well, that's what stable coins are for, right?
Yes. So the industry is evolving quite a bit. There's many other currencies coming into play, but I think institutionally, it might be tricky to say that this is the one that you're going to invest in.
Let's talk about Bitcoin as a currency now. What El Salvador did, which is to legalize Bitcoin as a form of payment, is that the trend for every single other country in the world, or do you think El Salvador is an anomaly?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. So El Salvador has a very small economy. It's a country dependent on imports more than its exports. El Salvador also does not have its own currency. It uses the US dollars traditionally as its own currency. And so what they did, they said, hey, we'll standardize on Bitcoin and we'll start using Bitcoin as our currency. But at the back end of it, there's many things that El Salvador needs to get right in order to make that work properly. Yeah. They've got to equip every person who's buying or selling anything in the country with some kind of crypto, with some kind of Bitcoin especially, right, or Satoshis. So what they're doing is they've purchased, I think, 20, I don't know the exact number, they've purchased a large number of Bitcoins, and now they're going to fund every citizen's wallet with some crypto in it in order for them to start buying and selling things. It's a really different way of kind of implementing a crypto. I would have gone the route of creating a crypto that's not Bitcoin related, but then it's pegged to something. So interesting development, but I have a few, you know, questions in my mind about how successful it will be because of many, many different trade related aspects to this whole thing.
What do you think about central bank digital currencies? You mentioned that not all countries need to do what El Salvador is doing, but a lot of central banks in the world are moving in the CBDCs direction. Why do you think they're doing that?
So central banks are under pressure from the crypto industry because people now have the power of having crypto and trading and buying things on it. Central banks definitely are feeling the pressure on needing to think digitally, right? And you see this happening in China, where the digital yuan has been in place for some time, and China is trying to, they have kicked out cryptocurrencies from China. They've stopped trading and banned all of those things that have happened in the past month and a half, which is very interesting. China has cited that it's the carbon footprint, it's many other reasons, but we know that crypto does not have as much of a carbon footprint. I mean, your lawnmower has more carbon footprint than anything else, right? So I think central bank related digital currencies are potentially going to come through more in the next 5 to 8 years. The question is how and who will be the first one. I see smaller economies, of course, adopting them more. Smaller regions doing them more. So we'll see. Yeah, I can't predict.
Moving away from cryptos, now going into the investment space, I think investors watching our show right now are interested to know from you, a scientist, a futurist, what the biggest disruptions in our society will be over the next 10 to 15 years. We've seen a lot of funds follow that model. Kathy Wood's ARK funds essentially invest in companies that she believes will be disruptors. So what do you think will be the biggest disruptors?
There's a lot happening in tech. We can talk about technology endlessly, but there's some that stand out. They definitely, in my opinion, without any specific importance, a blockchain technology definitely is the foundation of crypto. It's the foundation of NFTs, of smart contracts. And so for that reason, blockchain is really high on my agenda to follow. My documentary, Blockchain City, a couple of years ago, talks about blockchain and what it does. And so I think you need to watch the blockchain space and what comes out of it, right? NFTs are just one part of it. Blockchain is more related to creating a platform rather than just one commodity. So it's very, very, very important that we look into it. Artificial intelligence has been a buzzword for a few years now, but it permeates many aspects of what we do, the smart cars, the robots, you know, even things like RPA, that robotic process automation that many industries use is related to artificial intelligence in some ways. So AI is also growing at an unprecedented pace. Watch that space to see what it does. And it has so much in it, you've got to pick a lane and choose. We also have the Internet of Things, which is again about connectivity, about connected cars, about connected infrastructure, the development of smart cities. So a lot of big things are happening with that. And I think the Internet of Things is very interesting as well. Of course, algorithmic societies, algorithmic economies are growing. There's many things that need to be followed.
All right, and geographies, investors might be curious to know which countries or areas are leading the way in innovation right now. Is it still the US? Is it the Middle East? Is it the Far East? What do you think?
I think innovation over the years has spread out a little bit. It used to be concentrated in Silicon Valley or in the UK or London or Singapore, but now it has moved from these hubs into worldwide. You've got India that's innovating and creating solutions. You've got things happening in China from an implementation perspective, the manpower they have, the funding they have. A lot is happening in China. But of course, you know, the West, US, and all the developed institutions that have researched, the MITs of the world, they definitely are doing incredible breakthrough work. So they definitely need to be followed, and we need to see what they're up to. You need to have a global perspective now on being able to target innovation and focusing on where is it coming from. It's happening everywhere.
Right. Okay. Finally, I have a fun question for you. There's a number of scientists or thinkers, Elon Musk being one of them, who think that we're suggest that we may already be living in a computer simulation. Very few people in this world are actually real. The rest of us are just NPCs, so to speak, in a video game. Well, how much credence do you give to that theory?
I think Elon Musk is a good entertainer. He's a great he's a great guy with with some great innovative ideas, but I'd take his all his things he says a little bit with a pinch of salt, focus on your strengths, building yourself up, expanding your knowledge in today's era of so much disruption, technology, and things happening. I think it's time we go back and start learning the basics of things and take it from there.
And what can people expect from Ian Khan in the future? What are your upcoming films and works?
Well, a lot more is coming up. We have a documentary on the future of work coming up as to what the whole evolution and revolution of future of work is. We have AI, the next frontier coming up. I have a documentary on the microbiome coming up next year. So tons of new things coming up in the next few months and the next year.
Excellent. Let's keep in touch and follow up on those projects. Thank you so much, Ian.
Thanks so much. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Thank you for watching Kitco News. We'll have more from you in Dubai.
Kitco News, special coverage of the Future Blockchain Summit, is brought to you by Cook Finance, a revolution in DeFi asset management.